Our Old Testament reading is taken from Psalm 71, verses 1 through 18. In you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Rescue me and deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me and save me. Be my rock of refuge to which I can always go. Give the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked and from the grasp of evil and cruel men. For you have been my hope, O sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. From birth I have relied on you. You brought me forth from my mother's womb. I will ever praise you. I have been like a portent to many, but you are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise, declaring your splendor all day long. Do not cast me away when I am old. Do not forsake me when my strength is gone. For my enemies speak against me. Those who wait to kill me conspire together. They say, God has stricken him. Pursue him and seize him, for no one will rescue him. But not far from me, O God. Be not far from me, O God. Come quickly, O my God, to help me. May my accusers perish in shame. May those who want to harm me be covered with scorn and disgrace. But as for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteousness, of your salvation all day long, though I know not its measure. I will come and proclaim your mighty acts, O sovereign Lord. I will proclaim your righteousness, yours alone. Since my youth, O God, you have taught me, and to this day I declare your marvelous deeds. Even when I am old and gray, do not forsake me, O God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your might to all who are to come. The word of the Lord.
Let me get the microphone out. You liking this weather? You like the snow? Did you go play in the snow too?
Yes.
Yes. Well, Joey, I have a tough question today, and I think you might be up for it. Have you ever done anything wrong?
I made a mess when I cleaned my bedroom. Like a big mess.
He made a big mess, right, Mom? And what kind of happened?
Like, I was taking everything else, out, and I didn't clean it up.
Oh. Did you get in trouble?
A little bit.
What happened?
Mommy told me to clean it up, and I did.
Oh, you were obedient then, right? But did Mom Did Mom discover it, or did you kind of tell her what you did? Mom?
Discovered.
Yeah, Mom said she found what you did. Did you, then you had to kind of tell her the truth, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, in their sermon today, we're going to be talking about sometimes the truth hurts, right? And in your case, you had to tell Mom the truth, and what happened? Did she yell at you?
No.
What did you have to do?
I had to clean up my room.
Yeah. So sometimes when we do something wrong, and we tell the truth, even though the truth is the right thing to do, sometimes it hurts a little bit, because you had to do what you didn't want to do, right? And sometimes, even adults, we have to pay the consequences when we do something wrong, whether we intended on doing something wrong or whether it was a mistake. But what should we always do then? Should we lie, Joey? No, we shouldn't lie. We should do what?
Tell the truth.
We should always tell the truth, because when we tell the truth, that's what God wants us to do. He doesn't want us to lie. But sometimes we have to know that there's consequences, right? Now, have you ever done anything wrong yet?
Yes.
You have? already? What did you do wrong?
Actually, no.
That's very nice. Well, I'm sure that even when you do something wrong and you tell the truth, even though there's consequences, do you think your mom's going to stop loving you because you made a mistake?
No.
Mom's never going to stop loving you, but she'll love you more when you tell the truth, right, Mom? And you'll always be able to work it through, so don't be afraid to tell the truth. Can you do that? Can you always tell the truth? You can. Thanks for coming up, you guys. You can go back to your seats.
I guess you can sit down.
Some of you were motivated, some weren't. Our gospel lesson this morning continues where we left off last week. Jesus is in the temple, and he has read the scroll and declared that the prophecy of Isaiah has been fulfilled. Let's listen to see what happens next as Jesus confronts his hometown. All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself.' Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum." "I tell you the truth," Jesus continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to the widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha, the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Nahum, the Syrian. All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way." May God grant us understanding this morning as we meditate on these words. Last week we talked about what a homecoming means today. It's not the homecoming that we would expect, was it? No parade, no special feast, and surely no coronation of the king. I can't sense any joy, any excitement, any positive energy at all in the reading of this. What I begin to feel is a little uneasy. Perhaps there is envy or jealousy in the air. As Jesus continues to speak, you could cut the air with a knife. Now, all I can sense from those listening to Jesus speak is hatred towards Jesus. Hatred towards the one God sent to bring freedom and salvation. Things get tense, very tense, as Jesus speaks the truth that no one wants to hear. And sometimes the truth hurts. Jesus speaks truth and no one is willing to accept it. This is one of those instances in Scripture where scholars have labeled Jesus a rebel, for he begins to stir up trouble. He goes against society here, and the people take notice. This kind of attention none of us would want, but let's remember, we are not Jesus. Jesus had a task to do. He was not on our timetable, but he was clearly under the direction of his Heavenly Father. He didn't wake up and say, "Today I'm going to cause trouble," like some of us do. Instead, I think Jesus woke each day and said, "Today I will do as my Father has directed me." For Jesus, it just happened to be trouble. Jesus delivers a message that no one wanted to hear. He spoke truth, and it motivated the people to want to kill him. That was pretty powerful truth if it caused people to want to do something as drastic as murder. What we cannot ignore in this passage is that Jesus was protected when he spoke the truth. For it says that Jesus walked right through the crowd. He was unharmed, even though the people were going to throw him off the cliff. The people had a knee-jerk reaction to Jesus' message. I question what made them so angry that they thought the solution was to kill Jesus. That was pretty drastic, don't you think? Was Jesus speaking the truth to them, and they knew it was the truth? If they just thought he was making things up, do you think they would have ignored him and walked away? I believe they knew what Jesus was saying was the truth, and it hurt them to the core. Why else would they have reacted in such a way? Jesus teaches us that we too need to speak the truth, even when it's not what people want to hear. Hopefully they won't immediately want to stone us or throw us over a cliff, but know that some people will not be happy with us if we speak the truth, especially if the truth is not what they want to hear. So what's the answer? When we are called to speak the truth, let's first make sure it's God's truth and not our man-made truth. So how do we do that? How do we speak the truth knowing that it is the truth? We use scripture at all times with great care. We have compassion on all of God's children. And mostly, we live the truth. We demonstrate it daily. It's so funny that this was our lesson in Sunday school this morning. God keeps doing amazing things with our Sunday school class. We need to demonstrate in our own lives where our faith lies. Not just speak it, but to show people. Because you've heard it 1,000 times. That people will pay attention to what you do more than what you say. They'll remember what you did to them, how you made them feel, more than they will remember what you said. If you speak to anybody that's been in an emotional situation, be it illness or death or what have you, they will not remember the words, but they'll say, "Oh, I remember so-and-so was there. So-and-so took my hand." They won't remember words, but they will remember presence. They will remember what you did to help in that time. So let us model our faith with our actions. How should we react when the truth hurts us? Anybody ever been hurt? Yeah, we all have. Let's not use knee-jerk reactions like the ones used in the temple. Let's not look to kill someone simply because they were right and we were not. It's hard to look at the news these days when there's so much violence going on. So many small incidences have led to murder. And that's what made me think when I read this. Something that seemed innocent, perhaps, and the first thought was, let's throw them off the cliff. I think we act so much like those people in the temple. And I mean we as a society today. Instead of thinking, instead of looking to the way God would want us to react in situations, we make up our mind and it's a knee-jerk reaction. And 9 times out of 10, it's wrong. Let's remember when we are hurt or when we hurt someone else. Saying I'm sorry never is out of style. Admit it when you make a mistake. Now, unfortunately, Joey's mom caught his mistake. But he didn't lie. Lying doesn't work. He confessed what was done. And even though his mom made him clean up his room,
He told the truth. It doesn't hurt to say I'm sorry. Ask to be forgiven if you need to be forgiven. If the other party chooses not to forgive you, it's on them. It's not on you. You asked for forgiveness. Most of all, we need to be sincere in all of our speaking. Let's face it, no one is perfect. We will hurt others, and others will hurt us during our lifetime. We need to live each day trying to be the best that we can be, showing good examples of what the disciples of Christ look like. Following Christ's example the best that we can and sharing that good news with others. We need to be about kingdom work at all times, knowing that our purpose as disciples is to do just that. When Jesus stirred the pot of society, he was preparing for his ultimate journey to Calvary. Because he took that journey, we have a place with him, a promise of eternal life. How can we not live in that promise each and every day? We are human. We will make mistakes. We hurt and we are hurted. We are hurted? And we are hurt. But that should not change the promise we made to God when we accepted Christ into our lives. It can be a tough journey. But the thing we always need to remember is we don't travel it alone. God is with us, and he will never leave us. Sometimes the truth hurts, but lies will hurt so much more. Let's be truthful. Let's be bold. Let's be disciples that don't shy away from the difficult, but let's face the difficult with the power of our God. Amen. Let us go from this place realizing that the truth sometimes will hurt, but the truth is what we are supposed to speak. So let us speak truth in love and spread the good news to all of God's creation. Go in his peace. Amen.
Amen.